Welcome to the second video of my model storage robot project. In this video, I'll be introducing the hardware I built and used for this project. To reiterate, here's the big picture I developed in the first video of the series. If you haven't watched the introduction video yet, I'd strongly recommend it. In this video, I'll be focusing on the hardware part, including both the mechanical and electronic components that make up the model storage robot. These are the pieces that will be handled and stored by the robot. To simplify the construction, I've decided to use some uniform, mid-size Fischertechnik parts. These pieces have been around for a long time. As a kid, I used these things as wheels for simple car and lorry models. Now, they'll do nicely as some generic storable item. The reason I've chosen these parts in particular is that I have them in three colors, which you can see here. This allows for some additional fun tasks when building and programming the robot. This is an image of the base model I'll be using for my robot. There is no need to reinvent everything from scratch if you can simply take a proven model and modify and extend it, much like you would reuse software design patterns. Now, this isn't exactly the same model I used, but since I intend to modify it anyway and want to explain some of the modifications beforehand, this picture will do. This robot has four basic movement options. It can open and close its claw and extend or retract its arm, both of which are shown here using this blurry effect. It can also move the entire arm up and down, which is not shown here because otherwise you probably couldn't see anything but a huge blurry mess. And finally, it can rotate around a central axis using a slewing ring built into its base. Now, this rotary design does have its advantage for the original model, which was designed for teaching purposes, but it's not what I wanted, mainly for two reasons. First, with an inner radius of well over 20 centimeters, the entire robot would have become bigger than my working area. Second, building a circular storage area with a system based on a quadratic grid with some angled pieces in between would have been possible, but a lot more complex than I intended it to be. So, instead of building a rotating model, I simply chopped the model into two parts and mounted the column with the arm onto an undercarriage that moves along a set of tracks, turning the rotation into a translation along a baseline. At the same time, the robo interface on the right-hand side remains stationary. Since most of the motors and switches of the model are now located on the mobile part, this design alone would cause some issues with the cabling from the robo interface to the mobile part. To deal with this, and because I needed to free up some ports for additional tasks on the interface, I added an extension module to the model. This module can be connected to the robo interface and controlled by it via a ribbon cable, which is much easier to pull around than a set of 12 pairs of cables. It also has a USB connection and can be controlled from a computer, which is handy for testing purposes. But enough of the introductory talk, let me show you the thing being built. As you can see, I started off using the model built according to the instructions. Obviously, I've sped the video up quite considerably. By the way, sorry for the awkward color, I'm using an overhead, rather cheap GoPro style camera that either doesn't have a decent white balance, or if it has, I haven't found out how to use it so far. Anyway, as you can see, I'm omitting the base part and the slewing ring entirely, mounting the model into a regular base instead. Once the mechanical construction of the arm is complete, I put aside the instructions and focused on the undercarriage. I decided to place the extension module below the arm for easier cable routing. Since the cables will be very hard to track once the entire model is assembled, it's a good idea to choose a consistent assignment of motors and switches to ports and to document it. Here is the mobile part of the robot set on a provisional set of tracks. It will be able to move along its tracks, raise or lower the entire arm assembly, extend or retract the arm, and open or close the claw. Let's take a look at this in action. This is a close-up of the side of the undercarriage. In the background, you can see the red extension box with the barcode sticker and the USB cable going off to the left-hand side. The black box at the top is the motor with a gearbox attached. As you can see when it's turned on, the motor does not drive the wheels directly. Instead, it's connected to a cogwheel that will reach into a gear rack mounted between the tracks. The reason for this is that, especially under load, wheels tend to slip, even rubber-coated wheels like the one I've used here. To allow for reliable positioning, interlocking constructions like cogwheel and gear rack are a much better option. On the shaft that leads down from the gearbox, you'll notice something similar to a cogwheel. This is a special wheel that pushes and releases the switch it is mounted next to once for every quarter turn of the shaft. Since push and release can be sensed as open and close events, we'll be able to track the position to about 1/8 of a turn. With the cogwheel at the bottom that has 10 teeth, That's approximately 6 to 8 millimeters, good enough for our purposes. From the side, you can see how the claw is extended and retracted. Note that I've shortened the extensible part of the arm in an attempt to improve the overall balance of the model. Both this axis and the vertical motion of the arm, which is shown here, is realized using a worm gear. You can see, and especially here, that it's much easier for the motor to move the arm down than to lift it back up again. Finally, here's a close-up of the claw opening and closing. It uses a small worm gear as well. This is the mobile part of the storage robot with the extension module in the bottom. Since this part has four axes and we need one motor for each axis, all the output channels of the extension module are tied up. For each axis, there is one impulse counter like the one you've seen on the undercarriage drive mechanism. This allows for relative measurement of movements. In order to turn that into an absolute position and to prevent the robot from damaging itself, we need an additional end switch on each axis. Two end switches for each axis, one on each end, would have been better, but as you can see, the extension module is already maxed out. Now for the tracks and the storage bins. This is mostly straightforward construction work, so again, I sped up the video considerably here. Don't worry about the green pieces in the top left corner of the model or the ramps at the bottom. I've redesigned these parts later on and will explain their function in a moment. Note that it's only at this point during the construction that I actually built the drive mechanism of the undercarriage that I explained earlier. This is a view to the front of the entire model. Let's take a look at the individual parts. This is the mobile part we've already seen in detail earlier. It's sitting on the black tracks with a red gear rack in between. This is the robo interface that will run the low-level program. You might call it the brain of the machine. The extension module on the mobile part is connected to the robo interface via this rainbow-colored ribbon cable. The interconnect cable needs to be long enough so that the robot can move along the entire track. To keep the robot from entangling itself in the cable, I've placed it on a support arm. In a real-world application, you'd probably see a cable drag chain like this one, but I didn't have the parts for this. This is the storage area, 20 bins in total, stacked 4 high, to use the entire range of motion of the robot. I've placed rails on the front side of the compartments, mainly to keep parts from being pushed out of the bins if the positioning isn't accurate enough. This is the output area with 6 compartments. You can't see a lot from the front, so here's a view from a slightly different angle. There's an angled ramp located behind the output compartment, so if a part is dropped onto that ramp, it will be deflected to the front. This is the input and sensor block. You can see even less here, so let's turn this around and take a closer look. This area has two main functions. The green platform on top is where new parts can be placed to be picked up and stored by the robot. The thing with the yellow cap on the left side is a lamp, and the other component with the black cap that has a hole in it as well is a phototransistor, making this a photoelectric sensor that can tell the machine whether there's a new piece waiting to be stored. The lower area houses some optoelectronic components as well. In this case, we've got a lamp shining its light down at an angle, and there's a photoresistor or LDR above the illuminated area. We'll see what this can be used for in a minute. Now, let's see the machine in action. Keep in mind that I'm controlling the motors manually here, hence the inaccurate positioning and the erratic movements from time to time. Here you can see the ramps behind the output compartments in action. This is the input area I mentioned earlier. Let's turn on the lamp and watch carefully what happens to the input I8 on the left-hand side. It goes active as soon as the lamp is lit. Now let's put a piece onto the platform, thus blocking the path of the light. As you can see, the input I8 goes inactive again. This is obviously useful to check whether we can grab and store a new part. But what about the other photoelectric stuff beneath this? Let's take a look. In this case, the sensor is a photoresistor that is connected to a special analog input named AX. This means that the interface gets a numerical value ranging from 0 to 1023, depending on the current resistance, which in turn depends on the amount of light received by the photoresistor. When we turn on the lamp, the value is about 940, which in itself doesn't tell us much. The green floor beneath the sensor simply reflects a certain amount of light, resulting in a specific resistance. Note that it's important for the lamp and the sensor to be placed asymmetrically in order to avoid reflections on the sometimes very flat and shiny plastic surfaces. Now let's place a black piece in there. Obviously, black surfaces absorb most of the light, so very little gets reflected, making the resistance go up to a value of about 1023. With a red piece, we get a value of about 690, and a white piece reflects most of the light, yielding a value of about 530. As you can see, we can use this as a simple but effective color sensor, so the machine won't need to rely on human operators to tell it the color of the piece it is about to store. That's it from the hardware department, at least as far as the mechanical parts are concerned. We still need to program the robo interface. However, there's something else that requires some explanation first. You might have noticed this small piece of cable that is still unattached. This is the connection to the outside world, and we'll add some hardware here later on. Now, in order to allow for the robo interface and its counterpart to interact, we need to specify the interface protocol, and we need that specification before we can head off programming any of the two components connected via this cable. Seems like we have a topic for the next video. If you're interested in the progress of this project, there are a couple of ways to keep up to date. I have created a YouTube playlist you might want to follow, but of course you're also welcome to follow my entire YouTube channel. I'll also be blogging about this on the SAP Community Network or SCN. The link is in the description. You'll find the articles in my personal blog as well. If you have any questions, suggestions, or would like to leave any other kind of comment, feel free to use any of these channels to get in touch. I'm looking forward to it. Thank you for watching and have a nice day.